December 26, 2004. A massive tsunami is set on a collision course across the Indian Ocean. When it slams into the coastline, the force of the wave wipes entire communities off the map. Even today, it's hard to comprehend the sheer devastation.
In Indonesia, 150,000 or so people lost their lives. Even in Sri Lanka, which was more than 1,000 miles away, there were 36,000 people who lost their life. All told, almost 250,000 people.
Bruce Jaffe is a tsunami expert at the U.S. Geological Survey in Santa Cruz, California. Soon after the waters receded, Jaffe and his team traveled to Indonesia to study the aftermath with the hope of better understanding when and where other big tsunamis may occur. Tsunamis are waves generated by abrupt vertical movement of the seafloor caused by earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, landslides, or even an asteroid impact. This animation shows the birth of the 2004 tsunami with a magnitude 9.1 earthquake deep within the ocean floor off Indonesia.
Here the earthquake is propagating, and then when you put the water on it, all the water does is mimic the deformation on the seafloor. That creates the tsunami wave.
In some places, the resulting wave reaches 100 feet high when it strikes land.
This video is taken in Banda Aceh, the capital of the Aceh province of Sumatra. The tsunami was maybe 30 feet high. In the other parts of Sumatra to the south, the tsunami was 100 feet high.
Since the Sumatra tsunami, several others have wreaked havoc. This dramatic footage graphically illustrates the devastating power of the tsunami that hit after the 2011 Japan earthquake. The tsunami killed 16,000 people and caused a meltdown at the Fukushima nuclear power plant. Tsunami waves raced across the Pacific Ocean and hit California's coast 9 hours later. The surging water caused more than $50 million of damage to six counties, including Santa Cruz, where the force of the waves smashed docks and boats. In response to recent tsunamis, the California Geological Survey and State Office of Emergency Services partnered with the federal government to create new maps that model the potential strength and flooding from tsunamis. These playbooks may help minimize damage to California harbors and help coastal communities update their evacuation plans. To prepare for tsunamis, it also helps to study the clues they leave behind, which scientists can use to trace their origins and estimate when they may strike again.
Well, after the water has gone away, the sand is left behind. And so it's a record, it's a calling card, if you will, of the tsunami.
Big tsunamis throw tons of sediment onto shore. The larger grains of sand settle first, with the lighter sediment coming to rest after. This creates a sand layer that leaves a telltale tsunami fingerprint.
When you find multiple deposits that were formed many years apart, you can start looking at what the hazard is in an area, estimating on when that area might be hit again.
Since a major tsunami may only strike an area every few hundred years, studying these sand deposits can help spot possible hazard areas with little or no recorded tsunami history. Good places to investigate are geologically active regions, such as the Pacific coast of North America.
The Pacific is sort of one big hotspot. We've got trenches almost completely around the Pacific, and it has to do with plate boundaries.
For hundreds of millions of years, the plates, or rocky slabs, that make up the Earth's outer crust, known as the lithosphere, have moved around the globe in a process called plate tectonics. Over time, the pulling apart and crashing together of plates form the continents and oceans, as well as island chains, mountain ranges, and other features around the globe. Sometimes, when two plates collide, one is pushed under the other, creating areas called subduction zones. Normally, plates move just centimeters per year, but occasionally they move rapidly in one large snap. This violent movement creates big earthquakes.
If you look at what happened in the Indian Ocean, It was 600 miles long and 200 miles deep, though that whole slab has to rip and break. One slab, pulling the other slab down, it rebounds, huge amount of energy. That's a lot of water to displace.
It's hard to plan for an event that may only happen once every 300 years, but the State Office of Emergency Services and NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, have established tsunami hazard zones along the California coast. More than 6,000 tsunami hazard signs posted in coastal areas help direct residents to higher ground.
Tsunamis do occur along the coast here. San Francisco, we've had them in the bay. So yes, they are a real threat. They are rare to have damaging tsunamis, but when they do occur, those damaging tsunamis can be devastating. So a warning system in place is very necessary.
The warning system starts with NOAA's Deep Ocean Assessment and Reporting of Tsunamis program, or DART.
What we have here is the DART system, the buoy that sits on top of the water. You have the pressure sensor that will measure the pressure of the water above it. If it picks up a long period wave, being a possible tsunami, it will then transmit the information to this buoy. The buoy will then send it to a satellite, and then the satellite sends it to the warning centers.
After the 2004 Sumatra tsunami, NOAA expanded the DART program from 6 to 39 buoy stations in the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans. Although the system has been hampered at times by malfunctions, it's designed to measure signs of tsunami waves and relay the data to warning centers in Hawaii and Alaska.
Now, a tsunami will actually travel at hundreds of miles per hour. When a warning is issued, or if you feel an earthquake that knocks you off your feet, you need to get away from the coast. You need to go inland into higher ground.
Even if major tsunamis off the coast of California are rare, the damage they can cause requires constant vigilance.
Nature is very powerful, and we have to respect it. If we don't respect it, that's when it comes and gets us.